as Be Thou My Vision, which we need. And now, kids, you are welcome to head like a mighty rushing wind to your areas of joyful opportunity. Those of you who know today is Pentecost got that reference because every week. This is not, now, on Pentecost, this is the quietest they've ever been leaving. So it's like, it's kind of odd. Now, you know that just like the first Sunday in Advent, we always say that's Happy New Year because it's the beginning of a new year for Christians, all right, in our calendar year. Well, today is just like is Earl's birthday this week. Guess what? This is the birthday of the church. We celebrate the reality of Pentecost as the coming of the Holy Spirit, and this being the first day, really, of Jesus giving birth to his church. And the reality is this is something that we look back on as a celebratory moment, and we look on in the reality of the present, and we also say it's a future tense reality for us as well. We've been talking a lot about the Holy Spirit lately, and that is not an accident. It's really important in the life of our church. And when each one of us steps over the line of faith, what happens? The Holy Spirit comes and makes a home in us, resides within us. And that happened in that moment. When you said yes to Jesus, you had a personal Pentecost moment where, in a unique way, the Holy Spirit personally embodied himself in you. And it's not dependent on how you felt in the moment. You may not have felt much of anything in the moment, but it's still no less true. It's no less a reality because God declared it to be true. Everybody kind of celebrates birthdays in a wide-ranging way, right? Some people look at their birthday and go, I don't have a birthday, I have a birth month. And I celebrate the whole time. How many of you are, I'm just going to really celebrate the whole, I'm going for it. And how many of you are more like, you know what, I'm really not interested in another one of these days. I'd rather just pretend that that's not going to happen and move right along. Some people lean in. Some people are really low key. They don't want to make a big deal out of it. So our birthdays, just events that we celebrate a day in the past, or do they celebrate how alive we are now? That's a good question, isn't it? Are birthdays where we celebrate what happened long ago, or are we celebrating what's happening right now and what will be on into the future? At Pentecost, the Holy Spirit took up residence in the people who believed in Jesus. Happened powerfully for 120 people. It happened powerfully for about 3,000 more as well, and we'll look at that today. Let's pray. Lord, we give you thanks this morning for the reality of Pentecost. May it not be a moment to reflect on that is fit for a museum, but let it be a reality that permeates our very lives here and now today. We want your Holy Spirit. We want signs and wonders. We want to be able to see the reality of your great love for us and the power of who you are flowing through us and into us. We love you and thank you. I pray, God, that you'll help each person hear exactly what it is that you need them to hear, regardless of the words that come out of my mouth, and help me get out of the way so you can come and truly be the way, the truth, and the life in the lives of those gathered here this day. We love you. Amen. So before Jesus died, he told his disciples, I am going to give you the gift of the Holy Spirit. This is going to be a good thing. That I'm going away is a good thing because you're going to have power. You're going to have an advocate. You're going to have the ultimate friend. You're going to have a comforter to walk with you and guide you through life. And this will be a good thing. And of course, this went right over the disciples' head. They didn't quite understand this at all. And then when Jesus died, what did the disciples do? Well, they huddled together in fear behind a locked door. But then Jesus was resurrected, and they experienced the power of him being in their presence, and Jesus taught and spoke with them for 40 days as the resurrected Lord. And just before Jesus rose into heaven, ascended into heaven, Jesus had one final instruction for them. I want you to wait. Wait for the Holy Spirit to come. You're going to have the ultimate friend and guide on the journey with you. He didn't say how long they were supposed to wait. He just said, wait. But the disciples did this one curious thing that's kind of interesting during this period where they're just supposed to be waiting. they decided it would be a good idea to select another disciple to replace Judas. Now, there's no evidence that Jesus instructed them to do anything specific like this while they were waiting, other than simply being together in the presence of God. He said, just wait. But Peter blurts out, as Peter is the king of blurting things out. He is impetuous. He speaks before he has a contribution to make so many times in the Gospels. And he says, let's pick another disciple to replace Judas. And so what do? They cast lots. It's common practice in the Old Testament. It's similar to picking straws or to rolling the dice. But casting lots in an ancient Jewish culture was not seen as something that was like a game of chance, but it was more an act of faith. It was a way that they sought God's guidance. But guess what? This is the last time that casting lots gets any attention, gets any word time in the Bible. It doesn't happen anymore in the rest of the New Testament. Why? Because you don't cast lots when the Holy Spirit makes a home in you, and you have the Holy Spirit to discern and connect and to be guided into the future. That is the new act of faith. See, when the Holy Spirit makes a home in these first disciples, they were then led and guided in the power of the Holy Spirit to discern and decide the direction. For instance, like if you were to visit a leadership team meeting here at University Caroline, you would never see anyone, a pastor or a leader, pulling out some dice to make a roll. See, what's the right decision? I mean, should we get these brand new air conditioners? All right, no, we're gonna seek the guidance of the Holy Spirit, who wants us to have those cool rushing winds flowing through all summer long, right? So yeah, we get those. So we don't do that. We pray for God's discernment, God's guidance about the decisions that we make. All right, so now Jesus is resurrected, he's ascended into heaven, and 10 days later, which must have felt like forever. Like when you're told to wait for something, but you're not given a specific amount of time that you need to wait for a decision, you don't know what to do, right? So they're probably feeling like this is a really long time. So 50 days after the resurrection, we have the celebration of Pentecost. Now, Pentecost already had a rich and challenging and painful history for the Jews. And it was one of the key celebrations in Jewish life. It's called the Festival of the Weeks or the Festival of the Harvest. And it happened 7 weeks after Passover, so also 7 weeks after Jesus' death on the cross. And Pentecost was deeply connected to receiving God's word, to receiving the Ten Commandments that came to the people of God. Moses went up Mount Sinai. He spent time in the very presence of God. He got the commandments from God on the stone tablets, and when he came back down, what did he find? He found all the people being incredibly faithful and joyful and happy to see him, right? Is that what happened? No, it's not, is it? The people had been so worried that Moses was taking too long, and so they fashioned a golden calf. Actually, the Bible says what they said was they said they just threw their gold in, and this beautiful calf came out. They didn't fashion it at all. Yeah, right. Come on. All right, so they're all worshiping this idol that they've made. Moses is not happy. God is not happy. And as a consequence for this extreme disobedience, Moses asked the people, who's with me? Who is on the side of God's word in the form of these Ten Commandments that we have just received? And a group of Levites stepped forward, and Moses instructed them to get some swords and to run through the camp of 2 million people, striking some. And the Bible says about 3,000 people died that day. So 50 days after the Pharaoh had released the Israelites from Egypt into the wilderness toward the promised land, in the midst of all this reality, what happens is they get the gift of the Ten Commandments from God. They're moving towards their freedom. Oh, and by the way, 3,000 people die as a result of the disobedience. So Pentecost was and is the anniversary of the Old Covenant, of God's word coming in the commandments and receiving God's word It is about what God did long ago. But the point of the original Pentecost was that, yes, God is good. Yes, the law that's given to us is good, but the law also reminds us of our inability to live it out. Because the law points us to the reality of, yes, I am a sinner in need of God's grace. It points us to the reality that we fail. We bend the knee and worship false gods, false idols that are offered up to us. Now, hold that really incredibly uncomfortable thought in your hearts and minds as we spend some time in the second chapter of Acts, beginning in verse 1. It says, on the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. So at this point, there's the 120. Now, I want you to think about that. At this point, the Jesus movement has only 120 people after the three-year ministry of Jesus and his death on the cross, experience of the resurrection. He's got 120 followers. And this is what's going to change the world, right? And it will, in fact, do that. But it says, the reality is, the sound like a roaring, mighty windstorm filled the house. The word for spirit and wind come from the same word in Hebrew, and they come from the same word in Greek as well. And in the Hebrew word, it's ruach, and you can't say it without breathing out. You have to breathe out. And in Greek, it's pneuma. Like if you have pneumonia, you have what? You have a breathing problem. So if the spirit is blowing into you, you don't have a breathing problem. You have a life reality. So the Spirit of God shows up in the second sentence of the first chapter of the first book of the Bible, Genesis. And it says the Spirit of God hovers over the nothingness. The Spirit of God brought order from chaos. The Spirit of God brought light from darkness. And the Spirit of God brought something, the great something, from the nothing. And that was the very creation of the living God. And that's a powerful picture for us. And then in the second chapter of Genesis, we see the Spirit of God at work again as he breathes life into Adam. Wind and breath are symbols of the very presence of God. Verse 3 says, then what looked like flames or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. Now, fire is also a common symbol of the presence of God as well. You may remember Moses in the burning bush, that in that powerful moment, the bush is not consumed, and he's in the presence of God. And then as Moses leads the people into the wilderness, one of the promises of God, it says, I will be a pillar of fire with you by night to guide you and lead you forward on the way. So fire is a powerful symbol of God as well. And verse 4, and everyone present was filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. At that time, there were devout Jews from every nation living in Jerusalem. When they heard the loud noise, everyone came running, and they were bewildered to hear their own languages being spoken by the believers. They were completely amazed. How can this be? They exclaimed. These people are all from Galilee, and yet we hear them speaking in our own native languages. Here we are, Parthians, Medes, Elamites, people from Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, the province of Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, and the areas of Libya around Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans, and Arabs. Whew. I think I pronounced those all pretty well. And we all hear these people speaking in our own languages about the wonderful things God has done. They stood there amazed and perplexed. What can this mean? They asked each other. But others in the crowd ridiculed them, saying, they're just drunk, that's all. Now, that's really quite funny if you think about it. Think about what's just happened. There's this incredible miracle of these people. They speak 15 unique languages that they don't speak, and that other people now are listening to the good news of God's love for them and of his grace. So the reality for us is these people are saying they're so in the midst of this profound and incredible reality. They're speaking a deep truth in a language they've never spoken before. And the response of some of the people is to say they're drunk. Okay. No, that's a sign and wonder. That's a miracle. But the good news here, be clear about what the good news is. This is not like in other parts of the New Testament, we see what about speaking in tongues in a way that's about a prayer language. That's a way of communicating with God. That's a gift from God. It is one of the spiritual gifts in the New Testament. That's not what this is. This is the profound gift of speaking a language that someone else can understand and hear, that they might know the gospel. So that's different than a prayer language that needs an interpreter. So for 38 years, I've been a pastor, and I've always been prepared. If one day somebody began to speak in tongues in a worship service that I was leading, I've been ready. You know why I've been ready? Because the Apostle Paul gave really clear instructions about what to do, okay? And if anybody feels compelled today to do that, you just let me know. I'll make sure we have an interpreter. See, because what Paul says is in 1 Corinthians 14, 39 through 40. So my dear brothers and sisters, be eager to prophesy, okay? Speak a word from the Lord, and don't forbid speaking in tongues, but be sure that everything is done properly and in order, okay? Now, the reason why Paul mentions these two in particular, that thing about being done properly in order is true for every spiritual gift that God gives. But in this particular unique case, these were the things that were the most likely to be misused or to be problematic in the church in Corinth. And so Paul was saying, you know what? You use these gifts so improperly, you're so out of order that you need this direction. You need help in this area. And it's important for us to recognize that, like, yes, all good spiritual gifts are from God, and we need to be in order. Because the reality is, if somebody speaks in tongues, they're simply communicating with God. They're not communicating with people. But not the miracle of what happened, like, in Pentecost. That's a different reality. So the question more for us in our modern world might be, what language does God need you and me to speak to reach our world? What language do we need to speak that our neighbors, our friends, our acquaintances, people we've never met, might hear more clearly the gospel, the good news? The language of authenticity, the language of friendship, the language of love. Perhaps the language of service is something that's important. Obviously, the language of technology, it's a great way to share the good news. The first door that anyone today enters into the life of a church is through its website. It's important for us to speak in a language of technology, or the language that says that truth and grace is really important. Is a good language. And before we consider what language we might need to speak that others might be reached and hear the good news of the gospel, it's more important for us to also learn how to listen. Listening is good. Dietrich Bonhoeffer said, many people are looking for an ear that will listen. They don't find it among Christians because they are talking where they should be listening. But one who can no longer listen to his brother will soon be no longer listening to God either. He makes the link that if we want to hear from God, we also have to hear from the people that are all around us, that are in our lives. Listening to God means listening to others as well. And we need to experience the miracle of a listening ear in our modern world. Who in your sphere of influence needs the miracle of a listening ear before we speak in their language? See, when God connects us vertically, with us vertically in the power of the Holy Spirit, there is always going to be a horizontal result. In other words, will we see evidence in our daily lives when God shows up? The answer is yes, absolutely. We will always see evidence that God is at work in our midst when the Holy Spirit shows up. So the Holy Spirit didn't move those first century followers of Jesus away from interaction and connection from the real world, from day-to-day life, but the Holy Spirit now was going to guide and empower them as they walk through it. Guess what? That's true for us here and now today. The Holy Spirit is with us to guide us and empower us. The Holy Spirit fuels our mission and our ministry. Now, when I am on fire with my own fuel and forget about the Holy Spirit fuel that is within me, guess what? I am likely to get cranky and tired and burned out, and you are too. The reality is, I can serve Jesus in my own power, but why would I want to when God has already declared, Jamie, I have promised you the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit at work within you, working through you. Pentecost means that we get to serve others in the overflow of the Holy Spirit at work within us. That's pretty good news. Verse 14 and 15 says, then Peter stepped forward with the 11 other apostles and shouted to the crowd, listen carefully, all of you, fellow Jews and residents of Jerusalem, make no mistake about this. These people are not drunk, as some of you are assuming. 9 o'clock in the morning is much too early for that. See? Peter has a sense of humor here. What a great argument you're making, Peter, because, wow, if it's later in the day, you might have a point, people. But that reminds us that as we communicate good news in a language that people can understand and receive, we have to know, accept, and understand the reality that not everyone is going to appreciate hearing the good news in their own language, and they're certainly not going to receive it. In fact, some will outright reject us, and they will resent us for it. It doesn't mean we don't speak it. It just means we get ready for that reality. Verse 16 through 18, he goes on. No, what you see was predicted long ago by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit upon all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions, and your old men will dream dreams. In those days, I will pour out my spirit, even on my servants, men and women alike, and they will prophesy. Now, this is a word from God for us today. When we see this reality of Pentecost, we're not supposed to go, wow, that was cool. Wow, God, you really did an amazing thing long ago. It's a neat thing that you did in the past. No, our old men, our old women right here at University of Caroline are supposed to dream dreams, to have visions. We're supposed to hear a word from the Lord. That's all. Don't get afraid of the word to prophesy. It just means that we hear from God. We believe that God still speaks. He's still giving us a word in 2024. And the reality is no one retires from being under the influence of the Holy Spirit. You know what else is true? The reality for us is that our young men and our young women are seeing visions, are dreaming dreams. So the same disciples who were huddled together in fear were now driven out into the public in unexpected new places, in unexpected new ways. The church was born on this day. The locked doors were thrown open and they went public with their faith. And we are still called to do the same in the power of the Holy Spirit. We don't do this alone. We don't do this on our own. The Holy Spirit coming means that God intends to reach the world through us as we speak a language and live lives that people can see and hear the reality of the truth of the good news of gospel. And that's important for us. Each one of us gets to be a conduit of this good news of God's grace. And the question for us is, how will I speak? How will I live? How will I be good news for the people I come in contact in a way that they can understand and that some will even receive this word from God? But I don't ever want us to be a church that stops counting on God to show up with signs and wonders. I don't want that for us. Because here's what happens. In every generation, when the church stops expecting to do God to do great things, guess what happens? God stops doing great things among us. And the danger of thinking of Pentecost as a day from the past merely to be remembered is that it's sad. It says, God used to do great things through us, but that day is past. I want University of Caroline to be a church on fire with the Holy Spirit, so that we need to keep being open to new moves of the Holy Spirit. It's not just about what God did 2,000 years ago. It's not just about what God did 3,500 years ago. It's about what God's doing right now in 2024. It's about saying, look what God is up to among us. That's what this next weekend, Holy Spirit Weekend, is all about. It's about making space, making time to step back and linger with the presence of God, to see what might God do? What might God do in the midst of this time together? And that's a here and now reality for us. And then Peter kept preaching for, 33 or more so verses, and he kept going, and he was on fire. I mean, Peter, the one who had been in so much fear the night before Jesus' death that he denied even knowing Jesus three times, right? I mean, now he's bold, he's excited, he's preaching with power. So what was it that changed in Peter? Well, first of all, Jesus restored Peter to his ministry in John 21. For the three denials that Peter made of Jesus, Jesus asks him a question. He said, do you love me? And Peter says, you know I love you. Then feed my sheep. Do you love me? You know I love you. Feed my sheep. Do you love me? You know I love you. He's great pained by this reality. He says, feed my lambs. And so here we have this picture of Jesus restoring Peter. For the three denials, now Jesus comes back and says, I want you back in the feeding the sheep business for me, okay? And what's the other key change? Now the Holy Spirit makes a home in his heart. He's empowered. And as he preaches with great boldness, what is the result? We see the result in Acts chapter 2, verse 41. It says, those who believed what Peter said were baptized and added to the church that day, about 3,000 in all. Do you see what God does right here? In the old covenant of Pentecost, we remember that the good law was being given and that we couldn't live up to it. The reality for us is that the law only has the power to point out our inability to live it out, that we are sinners in need of God's grace. And that's a powerful reminder. We need that reminder. And on that first Pentecost, 3,500 years ago, about 3,000 people died. In the new covenant of Pentecost, we celebrate the good news that we are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone, and the Holy Spirit makes a home in us. And guess what God does? It says about 3,000 people experienced new life and received the Holy Spirit. Wow. We see Paul addressing this in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 through 11. It says, the old way with laws etched in stone led to death, though it began with such glory that the people of Israel could not bear to look at Moses' face. For his face shone with the glory of God, even though the brightness was already fading away. Shouldn't we expect far greater glory under the new way, now that the Holy Spirit is giving life? If the old way, which brings condemnation, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new way, which makes us right with God? In fact, that first glory was not glorious at all compared with the overwhelming glory of the new way. So if the old way, which has been replaced, was glorious, how much more glorious is the new, which remains forever? So, while Pentecost is about remembering the old covenant, it's mainly about celebrating the new covenant. And may Pentecost never be a day where we simply remember what happened in the past long ago, but that we celebrate what God is doing right here among us on a regular basis. May the Holy Spirit be alive and well at University Caroline and each of us individually, because that's another powerful thing that happens here. The Holy Spirit individually rested on each of those about 3,000 people that day, and that's powerful. Now, one of the things that we're going to do now is there are some people who have been listening to the Holy Spirit at our church. Friday moms, come on up on the stage, on the platform. We are going to commission them as they go get prepared to go on a mission trip to Guatemala. It's called Filters of Hope. And we want to celebrate them and the fact that they've been willing to listen to God's Holy Spirit. So if you would, as we pray for them and the power of the Holy Spirit, would you, if you're comfortable, extend your hands toward them? Look at that. And you need to instruct them to hold hands. They're going to do it anyway. So just extend your hands towards them as we commission them. Heavenly Father, I thank you for each one of these wonderful women who are responding to your Holy Spirit in power, in truth, in grace. May you be with them. I pray that you'll challenge them on this trip. I pray for a holy boldness. Yeah, we want them to be protected and safe, but more than that, we pray for your boldness as they share your word with people, as they offer an instrument that that cleanly filters water. And we just pray for them, and we pray your Holy Spirit will guide them through this entire trip. In the strong name of Jesus Christ, we all agreed and said, amen, amen. Let's give thanks for this team. Thank you. God bless you. And now let's stand together as we continue in our worship, as we sing some more songs.